technical glitches these days. Yeah, so broadly, everyone here together, we'll be going through. So we will be going through broadly about the entire information about actuarial science and how you can pursue it. Actuarial science, quant finance, data science. So now I just want this webinar to be a little interactive. So I've kept certain polls. I will poke you guys in case I want to ask any specific questions. So please respond so that it becomes a more informative and a better session. This is the best form of interaction that can happen, unfortunately, these days. So before I begin, I had one small question for everyone. Is basically, what is your career objective? Okay, so what I've done is done a small poll for everyone and would request everyone to respond. Yeah, what according to you is the career objective? And it's multiple choice, guys, so you can put in multiple answers as well. Yeah, and in case, guys, just minimize the screen for voting in case you are not able to vote. If it is full screen, you may not be able to vote, so just minimize it in case you want to vote. I'm just waiting for everyone to poll in. Cool. Yeah, these are multiple choices, guys. So you can select two things if you want. Great. So I'll just close it up. All have voted. And I will share the results, guys. So what everyone here has put up is majorly wealth and job satisfaction. Power, prestige, and make a difference comes in a little later on stage. Cool. So this is what I think everyone here is for. So whenever I decide a career, guys, I need to focus on these five aspects. Okay. The first aspect that I need to focus on is wealth. Obviously, paisa is the most important thing. So whatever career that I choose needs to be giving me money. Later on in your career, guys, these three things come into the picture, which is job satisfaction. Basically, what I'm doing needs to be satisfying. I should be doing something new every time I am engaging into something. I should have power or autonomy. I should be the person who's making decision or calling the shots. And whatever I do should make a difference to a society at large. So everyone here now entering into their professional career should look at all these. The basic thing starts with wealth. Once you start earning decent amount of wealth, is when all these three things come into the picture, or the four things come into the picture. Yeah. So broadly, I understand here everyone's looking out for wealth and job satisfaction. Later on in the course, everyone here would want that I am doing something new every day. It's not the same boring thing that I do. And I have some power. I control the organization, the way it thinks. Yeah. So based on that, guys, what we feel is these are the careers of the future. Yeah, if you can see my screen, the careers of the future that I see here is basically these streams. Now, why we are saying these are careers of the future? Because, guys, we think there are three big themes that are coming out from this lockdown. From this lockdown, the three big themes are automation. Everyone is required to work from home and is trying to manage stuff from home. That's the first big theme that has come out. And because of automation coming out, these two careers have got a big boost. The second big theme that's coming out of is risk management. And this comes out of actually every crisis, to be very honest. The reason risk management is important, guys, the point now is that if you survive the pandemic, you will be able to survive a lot of stuff. Okay. So that's one of the biggest things. So it's very important that you have managed your risks properly. because of risk management, these three teams are coming up. The next big thing that we observed was trade patterns. So what has happened is, because of this entire pandemic, trade practices are changing. The concept of globalization is going out. Now we have a new concept which is called as deglobalization. There are a lot of things strategically important that every company now wants to retain, or every country wants to retain within itself. That is why economic patterns are changing very drastically, and hence economics as a career is flourishing. Finally, the most important thing is that since this was a medicine oriented crisis or a health oriented crisis, epidemiology is one of the careers that have come up. In fact, epidemiology, guys, is a word that I heard only after the pandemic came around. So in the medicine field, this is a new stream which will gain a lot of momentum. So guys, based on this pandemic, what has happened, these already were the careers of the future, but because of the pandemic, this has been aggravated. So the thing that was supposed to happen in a span of 20 or 30 years now has happened within a span of 4 to 5 years, resulting in a lot of quick changes. I still remember, I hope everyone here knows Zerodha. It's one of the largest trading houses in India. His owner, Nikhil Kamath, hai. Nikhil Kamath came and, you know, at the start of the pandemic, the first thing that he told is, he realized that a lot of things could be done automated. There was not requirements of coming to a physical place. He said, the first thing when trade opens, I am going to automate a lot of stuff. We, in fact, are advising a lot of companies also to automate their certain processes, considering that they could survive this pandemic period. So this is like the immediate thrust. All these careers, guys, and these trade patterns or these things are at least going to remain in the next 20 to 25 years as strong business trends. Now I'll go ahead and start discussing one career that I've put up here. The first thing that I look up is an actuarial science risk management. Yeah. So before I begin, guys, I have a small question for everyone. So who, according to you guys, is the best batsman of all time? Who would be your choice? Again, what I've done is I've created a small poll so that I can get an idea. So I'll just put up the poll for you all. Yeah, in case you want to vote, guys, just minimize your full screen. You might not be able to vote. Who, according to you, is the best batsman of all time? Just waiting for everyone to vote in. We have quite a lot of Indians here, obviously. Just waiting for the polls to get done. All right, all have voted. So I'll just launch it. You know, everyone here majorly thinks Sachin is the best batsman of all time. And after that, some meager votes to everyone else. The point, guys, here, the point I have to make here is, guys, the answer wasn't that important. The answer wasn't that important. But the important thing was the thought process by which you came up with the answer. So what I'm referring to here is what you considered for rating Sachin as the best batsman. Was it batting average? Was it the number of score? Was it the highest scores? Was it the most century? Or you also have to put that, how and well did he play? What sort of pitches were there? How many games did he win? When Sachin scored 100, did India win? So all of these were material questions that you need to think before you come up with the answer. And the point is, when you communicate the answer, guys, you need to put all these numbers in context. So Sachin is the best batsman in the world if you're looking at the most centuries, highest averages. Yeah. But if you look at, let's say, the most times India Kohli is better because his average is even better than Sachin. Best stats player wins. Roshan, I agree, but what stats are you looking at is the important question mark here. it's not that Sachin would be good in all stats. I think Virat is better in the average stats. Sachin is good in the number stats. So Vivian Richards, sir, is good in some other stats. So what I'm trying to highlight here, guys, is the context is very important. And the example that I gave right now, guys, is what I mean by critical thinking. It is one of the most basic skill sets, guys, that everyone needs to have, okay, in order to pick up any career. Whenever I ask you a question, a critical thinking and a problem solving approach is what is required to become any of the careers that we are going to be discussing. Okay, I'll take it ahead. So what is actually actuarial science? Now, actuarial science, guys, is a profession which is a risk management and risk quantification profession. What do? They try to quantify risk using mathematical models. So when I go to quantify, predicting the risk is equally important. And finally, jab pata chal gaya, when you come to know that, boss, this is the risk, this is the impact, how do you minimize them, mitigate them, avoid them, is the basic goal of an actuary. Okay, there are various industries that they work in. They work in life insurance, non-life insurance, pensions, enterprise-wide risk management. They are into investments, health, data. I'll quickly run you through some stats that are there. Yeah, now it is one of the perceived to be, guys, one of the most difficult professions in the world. It is difficult, but that does not mean that, guys, it is not easy to pass. I'll draw a parallel for you all. Everyone here who come from the commerce background typically would look at CA as a profession. Okay, I would definitely tell you guys that if I compare actuary with CA, assuming you are coming from a commerce background, I would CA, guys, is very, very vast. Actuarial, guys, is straight in depth. So when I used to study for my CA exams, I used to study like 4 months, 5 months, day in, day out. I don't recollect studying more than a month or month and a half, day in, day out, for an actuarial exam. The reason is not that actuarial is easy. The reason is it's not vast. Matlab CA mein kya hota hai? You have to give 8 exams. It's huge. It's huge. Okay. Giving everything together really takes a toll. But actually, aisa nahi ek paper dena hai. You want to give one paper, give one. You want to go slow, you take it slow. So that's the big advantage that actuary enjoys. It goes more into the depth. Okay. To just put it into perspective, guys, India, and to put in perspective the opportunity for actuaries, guys, see, if I look at USA, it has 31,000 actuaries. If I look at UK, there's 14,000 actuaries, 15,000 actuaries. Germany, 5,000. Look at India. It's only 400 actuaries with a potential, I think, easily, because if I compare it to the population, if I put this as percentages to population, India would be like 0.0000. So it's a profession, very niche, very strong, and has a very beautiful area of application. Okay. And the opportunity that I see is quite large. The opportunity set is quite large. To give you an example, what companies are looking into, we have done a small case study of driverless cars. And you have this revolutionary guy, Mr. Elon Musk. Okay. He came up with a quote that he wants revolutionary actuaries. You know why? So if I talk about a car insurance premium, so right now, if you, let's say, you want to buy a car insurance, these are the factors that you take into consideration. Where do you stay? Jahan pe crashes. So typically, kya hota hai na, if you are a person from UP, Bihar, no offense, guys, wahan pe khali crashes zyada hote hai, toh wahan pe thoda zyada hota hai. Age and gender of the driver, typically male driver, young age, is a difficult area. Some history, some marital status, age of the vehicle, these are the factors that decide the premium. Abhi Elon Musk aake bolta hai, bhai, I have made a driverless car. It's an automated car. My software runs the car. All these factors that you're looking at become irrelevant for me because my software is driving the car. Yeah, only age and capacity of the vehicle is like a relevant factor to what I'm doing. So I require actuaries to basically rethink everything and change what they were doing. So the point is, if tomorrow there is an accident, who is to blame? The car driver or Tesla? So that sort of question started coming, and they have now started revamping the entire motor insurance pricing in the US. They are doing this everything again. What are the risks? How do you quantify them? How do you predict? And how do you minimize them? And based on that, according to Mr. Musk, the premium should come down by at least 30 to 40% because his software would be way better than a normal person driving a car. Quite an interesting fact, guys. He's already started working on it. If you go on LinkedIn and stuff, you'll see actually he's being hired in Tesla for basically deriving prices for all this. The next career, guys, that I want or we would be discussing is data. Now, data science, guys, is this is the fourth industrial revolution, guys. I hope everyone here knows what you mean by an industrial revolution. Industrial revolution is basically discovery of something which has greatly advanced mankind. The first was electricity, second was steam, third industrial revolution in the 80s was computers. This is the fourth revolution, which is called as data. Everywhere data will be driving decisions is the game here, guys, because there will be a big growth, and the pandemic has only accelerated the entire stuff. And data science as such is an all-pervasive profession. When I say all-pervasive, I basically mean it will apply in every area, be it marketing, be it software, be it finance, be it BFSI, anywhere and everywhere you will require data, guys. So to just put things into perspective, we have done a small video that I will be sharing with you all. I hope everyone would be seeing one video pop up. Yeah, everyone hopefully would be seeing a video pop up. This is a very beautiful video of data science done by Cadbury, yeah, which is called as a hyper-personalized ad. Would request everyone, I hope, can see it. In case you can't, the video is freely available on YouTube. Just go on to a Cadbury hyper-personalized ad. Okay, I'll just start the play. I hope everyone saw the video. It's a very, very, very supremely impressed by the way one could apply data. But I mean, this was just a very, very simple example. I can assure you there are lots of complex stuff that are going in this world. Yeah. The last set of career that we are going to be discussing, guys, quant finance. Now, quant finance, guys, is something which, I mean, over the last 2 years, we were very surprised that a lot of students did not know about this. So if I have to draw a parallel, guys, everyone remembers that you had a concept which was marketing. Marketing had broadly two aspects. One is digital and the physical marketing. So when I talk about digital and physical, how am I differentiating? Physical marketing, guys, is basically, just a second, I got a pop-up question. Rohit, I'll come to the questions now. Give me like 10, 15 minutes, yeah? So when I talk about marketing, we're talking about digital and physical. So digital marketing, guys, is something which has prospered in the last 5 years, okay? Physical marketing is something which was prevalent and now is fading, guys. Quant finance is something similar. When I talk about finance, there are two aspects of finance. One is the transactional aspect, which is basically accounts, audit, tax, all those aspects of finance. And the second is the quant, or more the digital aspect, where in quant finance, you use the latest technologies to drive decisions. Okay, this is a form of finance which is gaining a lot of momentum. And in the next 5 to 6 years, I feel this stuff would get highly automated. Okay, and there will be more and more focus on the quant aspect of finance. It's growing up very fast. So basically, the basic meaning of the profession is you are trying to apply certain complex mathematical models to the financial world. Okay. And a lot of headways. So it's so strong now that it is very heavily used even in the basic stock markets and other decision makings. Yeah, so I think this code is quite apt. Code is making the trading decisions these days. And why is this important? Is there is one small case study. I think everyone must have heard about ILNFS. Now, when I talk about ILNFS, guys, it was one of the oldest infrastructure leasing and financial services, oldest in India. Yeah, and it happened an ALM fiasco. So when I say an ALM, guys, it basically means asset and liability management. ILNFS did such a big fiasco that it lost almost this much amount, guys, 97,000 crore. And the point was, it is not that it was a small organization. It was owned by the best people in the country. LIC was owning 25%. HDFC Bank, or the parent of HDFC Bank, HDFC owned it. So it was one of the best companies. What wrong did they do? What did they do? They used to take money on a short-term basis and were using it for infrastructure. Okay. So what I used to do, I used to go to the mutual funds. I used to say, boss, give me money for 1 year. And I used to invest that in roads, tunnels, bridges. Now, the point is, why did this? I mean, it's like a basic asset liability mismanagement. I have to pay a liability within 1 year, but the asset, which is the road, is going to pay me after 4, 5, or maybe more than that years. Why did it survive? Because for the 10, 15 years, the liability size, the mutual fund guys never asked for money. They were saying, okay, we will renew it. One fine day, they came up and say, boss, I don't want to renew. Give me the money. And that's when the bubble burst. Okay. It is one of the largest fiascos in India and very, 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 very beautiful. I would urge everyone to read what is ALM and what went wrong in ILFS. It's a very beautiful fiasco. I'll not say beautiful. It's a very big scam that had happened. Yeah. And a big loss that happened. Yeah, a basic error of ALM, which after hindsight, but jab hota hai, tab people don't realize it. Now, I'll start bringing something about ourselves after getting into the career. So we have a brief idea about the program and everything. So the entire thought process, guys, about IAQS was to develop a program which gives an idea to the students about the industry realities that are there. Okay. So it's a part of the Patkar Verde College and affiliated college to the University of Mumbai. We give a program in the actual science and the quantitative finance domain with the basic thought process that we feel there is a big gap in what you study and what do you apply, and it needs to be filled in such a way that this becomes, there is a proper bridge between education and career. Yeah, so we are attempting here to revolutionize the entire education to provide holistic developments to the students. That is our main vision and mission, which is basically to revolutionize education. And basically we have this, which we call as industry academia. Throughout the program, what we have kept a thrust on is you have industry coming and discussing stuff with you. About the program, it's a 3 years program involving 6 semesters. It's full time. It's a bachelor's program. It is offered by University of Mumbai through Patkar Verde College. Its location is KCCMS, which is at Colaba. Yeah. So this is about the program. Yeah, 3 years program. It's the only program, guys, which is basically recognized by the IFOA for exemptions. So when I say this, what do I mean by it is that if you score well in this program, you will be exempt from the entire core principles. All the 6 core principles, if you are looking at the new 2019 curriculum, and if you are looking at the earlier curriculum, it is 8 core technicals. Yeah, all of them would be exempt if you score well. There are conditions to that. Yeah. So the point is, guys, you get a degree which is recognized globally because it is coming from the University of Mumbai. You get an accreditation from the IFOA, which will exempt you from 6 papers. And you get an entire network that is there in terms of internship placements, because internships and placements are a part of the program. Yeah. And this is the only degree in India, which is degree program in India, which is recognized by the IFOA for exemptions. The broad highlights, guys, of the program is that you have a dedicated placement cell. You have a global reach because there are lots of international tie-ups and internship opportunities. Already we are tied up with, for the data, for the quant finance piece, we are already tied up with UNIC, which is University of Nicosia. Yeah, we are, I mean, going to soon announce a program in digital currency with them. Yeah, which is basically Bitcoin, which is going off the roof right now. Yeah, digital currency, cryptocurrencies, we are already tied up with them. So we get a global reach. We are already talks with a lot of other universities as well. The IT skills, which I feel is the mandate these days, you will learn as a part of R, Python, Microsoft Excel, and SQL. And when I talk about Excel, guys, we get into VBA and coding. We require a lot of stuff to be automated. Yeah, it complements all the courses that are available in finance, actual science, CFA, FRM. If I want to do CFA, FRM, it complements them to a great extent via the formal education system. We have broadly always tried or strive to ensure that maximum faculty is industry, so that when they are coming and giving their experience, basically you get a direct experience in the lecture theater. So broadly, I think somebody would be having this question that who should be doing this program. So the first thing is you should enjoy math. You should have an enjoy math and have an aptitude. So I should be liking and having an aptitude for math. The second thing is you should picture yourself to be working in what we call as the BFSI domain, which is banking, financial services, and insurance. You should like the financial world, guys, because the application of data and everything we would be doing majorly in the financial world. You aspire to understand and ability to predict future trends. So basically you want to predict the future, or want to, I would not say predict the future, but want to understand the future and strategize based on that. And you should be working for big multinational companies, because it's a profession which involves a lot of data, and data is generated in large organizations or MNCs. Yeah. So broadly, if this is the thrust that you are looking at, then this is the program that should you should definitely look at. Yeah. It is 10 plus 2, which is your 12th standard from any stream. There's a test. Guys, the test is designed so that you have certain minimum math. The level of math is not that high for starters. It is purely based on your 11th, 12th maths. It's an MCQ based online test, yeah, which you can give it online at your home. After that, there is an interview. Again, it's a non-technical interview. So it is just to check your verbal communication and reasoning skills. So after these two, you are eligible for admission. In case you have done any actuarial paper or cleared ASET from the Institute of Actuaries of India, then this is exempt. You don't have to give the aptitude test. There is only an interview based on which you are selected. Guys, the purpose of this is that we are open to any stream. It should not happen that someone just enters and does not have a basic level of math that is required. So if I come up from the commerce background and I, let's say, I've done SP, I still will want some level of math that is there in the program, which otherwise you will falter in the program, which we don't want. Broadly, what we have done, guys, is since you are contemplating a lot of stuff, we have collated broadly the options that are there. In case you are planning to get into purely into data, you get into statistics or engineering, and then try to do independent diploma programs, which is available across a lot of platforms, Udemy and all that. You do those. In case you are looking at actuarial science, you get into these streams and give actuarial exams. In case you're looking at quant finance, you do again these streams and try to give this professional exam. So guys, if you appreciate here, there is a break. So when I say, what do I mean by break? My university kuch kar raha hun, qualification kuch kar raha hun. Okay. Jiski wajah se, I'm doing something at my university level and some at my qualification, because of which there is a broken understanding that comes in. Okay. And this is what we have been facing across the domain. So just to highlight the problems, guys, that are there right now, is basically, when I see here, there is no organized route. There is no formal education as such. What do I do is basically I study something in graduation and I do something. The degree sometimes is not recognized. There is no continuous study support. What happens is there is a complete break. The last part is all of these are distance learning mechanisms, so I don't get a practical exposure. When I go into employment, I have two diverse breaks. This is my graduation. This is my certifications. I try to merge. My employability becomes a problem. And many times, since I'm doing this on a distance learning mode, there is a problem to meet this. What we have tried is try to come up with the solution. The course that we are referring to is a solution to all this. It is through the University of Mumbai that you get. It is a degree that supports all your professional skills. In case you want to do any professional skills along with that, it matches to a great extent. There is an intense continuous study support, which is the LMS that we have. You are continuously in touch with the lectures, faculties. In fact, all our lectures are recorded irrespective of the pandemic. Even before the pandemic, the lectures were recorded. At any point of time, anyone wants to see any piece can easily see it. Wants to engage, wants to work, everything's there. There are capstone projects as a part. In fact, our students just completed one capstone project along with a placement partner, which is ACES. They gave a project into the banking world and the students were told to do it. There was one more capstone project which was given in the first year, which was of general insurance. So the point is there are continuous job-oriented learning that is happening here. There is an employability because we provide an internship as a part of the program in the second year. In fact, guys, already I would say 2-3 of the students who are there in the second year have been placed. They have been given internships. And the biggest thing is that all our faculties are majorly industry experts who come here and teach. a quick comparison that we have done with all the things. This is a little complex chart. I'll just try to explain here. We have done on a rating on a basic scale of 5 for these factors. So if I talk about software learning, we would rate our program on a relative of 4, yeah, as compared to an engineering of 3. If I talk about specialization, we would rate ourselves around 3, which is comparing with all these BAF, BBI. If I talk about industry placements, we would be at the top end of the spectrum. Relevancy of the curriculum. Management studies is something which we don't touch upon because we don't feel right now management is that important. We broadly touch upon the technical aspect. So we are very focused on the technical skill sets that you derive. A quick comparison, guys, so that you have a great idea as to how the program fares in comparison with all the other options that you are looking at. In case anyone here wants to get into the master's end of curriculum, you have anything on the actuarial domain which is available all over the world. On the quant domain, you can get into Toronto Sloan School, MSc Finance, anything into finance, it's important. Get into data, anything into data is also quite possible. So all these things, in case you are looking at anything of this sort in the master's, this is the best case. Guys, when I talk about abroad education, the degree becomes even more important because abroad people don't value, and I'm specifically talking from the point of US and Canada, people don't value professional education that much. It is only in India that professional education is given a lot of importance as compared to the degree education. If I go abroad, wherever I see, maximum impetus is given to the graduation, the post-graduation studies. Professional is a bywork. Okay, so any of these streams that you are looking at, when I talk about the courses, you can look into this. Apart from that, any of the normal MBA in finance, any of the normal courses that you are looking in, any of these three fields would be open to you. It's not, guys, that you will get restricted to actuarial or you will get restricted to any particular area. The domains remain open to you throughout. I'll talk about the current student profile that is there right now. Yeah, right now, yeah, it's a little dominating towards the male, but we have people across all the boards. We have international students as well right now studying as a part of the program. Yeah, there are a lot of students that come from outstation. The split between commerce and science, guys, is almost equal, I would say. Almost equal. Yeah, so there are equal number of people from science and commerce that are there. I'll go ahead. Now, the reason why we are harping so much on the placements, on the all the other aspects of the program is because of this, because of the entire curriculum is backed by the advisory board. We have Thomas sir, who's chairman at LIC, Nilesh sir, who's managing director at Kotak, Souvik Da, who is the technology lead at Tata Digital Services, the Tata Group. JV sir, who comes from the general insurance domain, he was an appointed actuary at ICICI Lombard, now is a director at Willis Towers Watson. We have Pratibha ma'am, who helps us with the entire international piece in case anyone wants to go abroad and wants to get into those areas. She helps us with respect to that. Shiva sir helps us with the entire bringing the entire sanity to the program because he's also a great cybersecurity expert. Rajesh looks into the entire valuation aspect. And how do you apply the skills of I'm referring here, guys. I'm referring that they are being backed by the Yes, you can hear me. My screen. Can everyone hear me, guys? I will now quickly come on to the questions that are there. Just confirm if you can hear me. Yeah, okay, cool. So broadly, the industry academia sessions that had happened, we have all the done in the our placement partners, which we are in talks with, and we become our partners into the entire program.